Hello, this is Marcel from Genelec and welcome to this tutorial about the GRADE report. GRADE stands for Genelec Room Acoustic Data Evaluation. This report can be really useful for you to find out the best placement of your system, and you can evaluate where acoustical treatment could be needed, and if you already have acoustical treatment, how effective it is. I'll now guide you through all of the paragraphs and show you examples. So to make it easier for you to understand what this report is about, and what you can read out from all of these diagrams. Let's start. So first of all, how do you get your GRADE report? This is done directly before AutoCal. So if you click on Start Calibration, you will see this new window in 4.2. And this offers you the option to enter your room dimensions, which is important for the time domain. And you can find a small checkbox saying Generate GRADE report. Because this report will be sent to you by email, you will have to be logged in. So just check this box and you will receive your report after a few minutes after you finished AutoCal. The report looks like this. It's a PDF and depending on the size of your system, it contains a lot of pages. We have a listing of the contents and as you can see, there are main categories and we have paragraphs. And as I said before, we'll now have a look at all of them. Chapter 1, Information. This is quite easy to explain because it simply shows you what this report is about and why we think it's a really good idea to use it. Chapter 2, Summary. We start with a summary of your system. So you will find all of the devices, speakers and subwoofers, and you can find out how good the performance is in different categories. And we use some color coding that it's easier for you to understand. So green, as you might have guessed, is excellent. So usually really good placement, a good room, good acoustical treatment. If you see things in yellow, this is still on a really good level. And even if some things are red, this should only point you towards that there is something that could be improved. For example, by better placement or by acoustical treatment, or sometimes simply move closer to the speakers. Chapter 3. Frequency domain analysis. These graphs should look familiar to you because this is something we have shown in GLM for years now. And it shows the red curve, which is the situation in your room that has been measured. The blue curve are the filter settings we use to compensate for the room influences. And the green curve is the resulting frequency response at your listening position. In these two examples, you can see on the left side, I would be really happy with the bass range because there are no notches. On the right side, which is from my living room, which is not acoustically treated at all, you can see there is a deep notch at 75 Hz. And if I see something like this, I usually think about what could be the cause for that. And in most cases, it's a cancellation caused by a wall reflection. 75 Hz would lead you to approximately 1 meter and 10 centimeters. This is the quarter wavelength rule. If you are interested in it, just check out our monitor setup guide. And if I know this distance, I can try to find out, hey, is it a distance, for example, to the front wall or to a side wall? And then I can bring the speaker closer to this wall to avoid this cancellation. We also show the frequency response of the subwoofer. Once more, in this example, I would be really happy because, as you can see, it's a linear response after calibration. If you would see notches here, then please always try out a different positioning of the subwoofer. It should always be close to the wall, once again, because of the cancellations, but then you can move it to the left side or to the right side, because of course also sidewalls can interact. And if you are not sure, just make one group with the subwoofer only, and then move it, measure the frequency response, move it again, and then it's easy to find the best spot for your subwoofer. As you might have guessed, in the ideal world, the frequency response from your left and right speaker in a stereo system should be similar. So this is what you can see in this diagram. On the left side, this is a detailed view where you can see, of course, there are some differences, for example, caused by reflections of your desktop or a mixing console. And on the right side, this is smoothed by one octave. What's also shown here is what you can find in GLM as well, the level compensation. So for example, one speaker is in a corner, the other one is not. Then of course the frequency response is a little different, and sometimes it's needed to do a level compensation that in the end you will get a proper stereo image with a precise phantom center. Another advantage of having speakers or subwoofers close to the wall is that you somehow can get a lower minus 6 dB point, simply because the energy that is reflected also adds to the direct signal. And so in this example, you can see that a speaker that we specify for a minus 6 dB point of 32 Hz, which is under anechoic conditions, can in the real world reach, for example, 25 Hz, simply because it's placed close to the wall. Or the subwoofer, which usually should play down to 19 Hz, can reach 12 Hz. So you can see, you will get lower bass and of course a higher SPL if you have the speakers or the subwoofer close to the wall. Summing of symmetric monitors is, as the name says, about symmetric monitors. So you know that you can have monitors as a symmetric group, though they share exactly the same filters above, let's say, 300 to 500 Hz. And once more, this graph shows you if there is a difference, so it's easier for you to spot. In this example, you can see, for example, there's one big difference at approximately 250 Hz, simply because one speaker has a notch there and the other one does not. After looking at your frequency responses, it can be helpful that you see which are the important parts to look at. And this is why we mark peaks and notches. And as already said, the notches are of interest because boosts can usually be compensated by using EQ. This is what we do in GLM. But notches, for example, caused by cancellations, cannot be compensated using EQ. So these can only be compensated by a better placement or, of course, acoustical treatment. In addition, we also show these peaks and notches in a table. So you can find it listed which frequency, which gain, and which Q factor. This also is helpful, for example, if you see there is a deep notch, but the Q factor is high, so it's a really narrow notch. It's not that critical compared to a wider notch. Chapter 4, the time domain analysis. You might know that ideally all of the speakers should have the same distance to your listening position. In a stereo system, this usually is easy to fulfill. Simply measure the distance between your listening position and the speakers. But if you have, let's say, an immersive setup with a lot of speakers, sometimes it's not possible to mount them at exactly the same distance, and therefore we use time-of-flight compensation. So GLM can detect the differences in the distance and will then automatically compensate for it. And this graph shows you the time-of-flight before and after calibration. For my stereo system, they look identical because, as you can see, there is no time of flight compensation applied. But as said before, in a surround or an immersive setup, you will see clear differences and the speakers get aligned so that the sound from every speaker reaches your position at the same time. Something you should always take care of are early reflections. This means once again, you have the direct sound from your speakers and then the reflected sound. And this can cause colorations, comb filtering. So it makes sense to reduce the early reflections as good as possible at your listening position. For example, using absorbers. In this example, you can see a treated room on the left side, and you can see there's only one critical early reflection marked by one. On the right side, once again, my living room, you can see there are a lot more early reflections. The overall level is higher because this room is more reverberant, so you get more diffuse sound, which of course is not ideal if you want to evaluate what's coming from your speakers. In addition, we show you which distance is related to the reflection we see. For example, here it's approximately 1 millisecond and the distance is around 35 centimeters. And this would mean a dip at approximately 490 Hz. And this is also marked with this blue line in your frequency response. Once more, this makes it easier for you to spot early reflections, for example, to find out, is it my desk, or is it a sidewall, or is it my console? And then you can think about how to optimize that. For example, on the sidewall, use an absorber. If it's your desktop, bring the speakers to ear level, for example, using a table stand. If it's your console, once again, just try to have the speakers at ear height. And now we can have a look at early versus late sound. This is of huge interest because it tells you, are you listening to your speakers, so to the direct sound, or are you listening to your room, the diffuse sound and the reflections? And of course, the perfect thing is that the green curve, which shows the early reflections, is always higher than the red curve, which shows the late reflections. On the left side, you see a good example of a project studio. And this studio uses absorbers, which are effective to approximately 300 to 400 Hertz. You can clearly see exactly in this range, the corridor somehow between late and early sound gets bigger, which is a good thing. So the late sound is reduced, the early sound can reach your ears without any disturbance from the diffuse sound field. And on the right side, you see that the red curve and the green curve are almost at the same level. This once again is an untreated room. And this means that in this room, it would be really hard to make mixing decisions because you are listening to your room almost on the same level as to your speakers. In a room like this, it could make sense to get closer to the speakers because this also improves the ratio between direct sound and reflected sound. Chapter 5, the time frequency domain analysis. We start with the reverberation time, which shows how reverberant your room actually is. For example, if it's a large room with no treatment, you will see really long times here. If it's a treated studio room, the times are shorter. And once again, of course, it's better to have shorter decay times because this means that you can get a lot of direct sound and the diffuse sound from the room is reduced. It's completely normal that lower frequencies ring longer in your room, so that the reverberation times of lower frequencies are higher compared to mid and high frequencies. The corridors that are marked here in green are for your specific system. So if you compare the left to the right side, you see this corridor is moving. Because if your room in total is a little more reverberant, we'll bring this corridor up. So this has nothing to do with a specific ITU limit. This is just to show you in which frequency range your system somehow has the same reverberation time. An excellent tool to evaluate the time frequency domain are waterfall diagrams. In these diagrams, you can see how long specific frequencies ring in your room. So the shorter, usually the better. You can clearly see that standing waves or room modes ring longer, and these are marked with lines in the waterfall diagrams. Once again, on the left side, you see a treated project studio. And you can see everything is well under control, let's say above 100 Hertz, because the decay times are short. On the right side, an untreated living room, and almost all frequencies ring longer in the room. So the right side definitely would need some acoustical treatment to bring down these decay times if you want to mix there. In addition to the waterfall diagrams, we show the decay of room resonances as graphs. And we show you the main resonances of your room. In this room, it is 40 Hertz, 65 Hertz, and 130 Hertz. And you can always see the corresponding decay times. And as I said before, the lower you get, the longer the decay times are. And unfortunately, it's also harder to find good acoustical treatment that is effective in the lower bass range. So for example, you can make use of bass traps or plate absorbers that are tuned to your specific modal frequencies. And as a summary, we show the room modes in a table for all of your speakers and subwoofers, and we use some color coding to show you which frequency range is affected. An excellent tool for spotting reflections and the overall energy in your room is the Wavelet. And you see colors towards orange or red show a lot of energy, and colors towards blue less energy. On the left side, this is once more the treated project studio, there is one spike you can see at 1 millisecond. And this is exactly the critical early reflection that had been shown before. On the right side, the untreated living room is worse because you see a lot of spikes. and you see especially a lot of energy around 1K, also caused by reflections. You can clearly evaluate what's going on and if there's a need to optimize things, once again, for example, by using absorber panels. Chapter 6, ITU-R BS1116 compliance. And finally, we want to show you how your system in your room performs if you compare it to a really strict standard by the ITU. And we start with the operational room response curve, which shows a corridor. Ideally, your frequency response after calibration at your listening position should be in this corridor. On the left side, the system completely fulfills this requirement. On the right side, it almost fulfills the requirements. You can see the right speaker is slightly off at approximately 700 Hz. As discussed before, early reflections are of huge interest, and therefore the ITU defines a limit of minus 10 dB compared to the direct sound. For this example, there would be one strong early reflection, because this is above this limit of minus 10 dB, this one is at minus 8. And you can then try to find out what is causing this reflection. Once more, we have a look at the reverberation time, but this time with the strict limits of the RT60 defined by the ITU. Where exactly this corridor is set, of course, depends on the room size, and therefore we ask you to enter your room dimensions before you generate the grade report. And the final table shows the overall compliance regarding the ITU norm. Chapter 7, Glossary and Acronyms. If you read all of the explanations in this report carefully, there might be some terms you're not familiar with, and therefore we have the glossary and acronyms. Yes, and this is the final chapter of our grade report. Thanks a lot for your interest. For more information, please visit our website. We have a dedicated page about the grade report. There you can find easy-to-understand explanations for all of the paragraphs and examples. To get in touch with us directly, please use support@genelec.com. For all immersive audio-related topics, please use immersive.helpdesk@genelec.com. Thanks again and see you soon.